Good morning.
Good morning.
As we gather as the body of Christ, let us humble ourselves in the attitude and posture of prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the brightness and briskness of this morning. We thank you for another day of life. And as we do gather as your church family, we ask that by your Holy Spirit, you would guide us into a deeper understanding of who you are and who we are and who we can become through your Son, Jesus Christ. So may what we do here, may what we say, always be a joy to you and a witness for your Son, Jesus Christ. Through this season of Lent and through all seasons, now and forevermore. Amen.
Morning. If everyone could please join me for the call to worship. Today is alive with fresh possibilities.
In Christ we are accepted and renewed.
In Christ we are given forgiveness and grace.
In Christ we live in celebration and joy. Let us worship the Lord.
Thank you.
Now for the call to worship, or I'm sorry, call to confession. God of grace, forgive us for wandering off into the far country and away from your ways and will. Forgive us when we withhold from others the forgiveness we seek ourselves. Warm us with your love, that we may reach out to the world in need of your compassion and grace. In Christ's name we pray.
Amen.
Friends, God, through Jesus Christ, forgives us. Because of his great love for us, who is rich in mercy, he made us alive with Christ, even though we were dead to our transgressions.
Amen. Sharing in the Apostles' Creed. I believe
in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is sitting on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. The scriptures tell us that God has blessed us in so many ways, so that we can approach God's throne of grace with confidence, that we can not only receive mercy, but find grace, especially to help us in our time of need. So now may we take these moments to offer ourselves in prayer. Let's pray. Almighty God, as we do move through this season of Lent, we come to worship you. We praise you for your fulfilled promise, as you've told us in all generations that you'll never leave us nor forsake us. We are thankful that you are with us as we contend with our lives and as well as with our challenges. Thank you for listening, and may our prayers always be filled with not our will, but always yours. This day, Lord, we proclaim, as is written in your scriptures, one does not live by bread alone. So we ask that you strengthen our families this day, our church family, and the community. Nurture the bond between us and inspire us to live with empathy and forgiveness. Help us and help those who are struggling, especially those who are out of work and looking. For those who are facing uncertain futures, may they find peace in your abundant love. Lord, as our Redeemer, we ask that you rescue us when we stumble. We also, this morning, as your children, once again proclaim that we are to worship you and serve you only. Help us to acknowledge and admit the temptations of the world and resist from turning away from your word. Awaken us to recognize the gifts that you have given each to us and see the role we can play in this church and in the healing of your creation. Be with our leaders here and in around the world, that they may act with compassion and generosity. Walk with our military. Be their strength, their guide. Protect them as they protect us. O God, our Creator, inspire us with renewed hope. For we acknowledge, do not put you to the test. Father, we ask that you would help us by your Spirit to deepen our faith, to hear your word, and certainly follow your way. Comfort us when we are dealing with illness or health issues, especially those who are fighting the COVID virus. Help them and grant them healing and patience. Help us as we move through this season of winter. We ask that you walk alongside those who, especially in these moments, are without water or power. Restore them quickly. And may your assistance be one of the ones. Father, especially through your Holy Spirit, sustain us in times like these. And as we continue in this season of Lent, help us to conduct ourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. And so once again, we turn to you before your throne of grace and share with you and with each other the prayer that your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Pardon me. Before we dive into the scripture today from Isaiah, please join me in the prayer of illumination. Holy God, by the gift of your Spirit, let us be grounded in your word, always growing in your wisdom and bearing good fruit in your world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All right, so our first scripture lesson today is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 30, verses 1, 15, and 18. Yes, I know it's a short one today, thank God. Thank you, Pastor. Listen now for the word of God. Woe to the abstinent nation. Woe to the abstinent children, declares the Lord, to those who carry out plans that are not mine, forming an alliance, but not by my Spirit, heaping sin upon sin. Verse 15 says, this is what the Sovereign Lord, the Holy One of Israel, says. In repentance and rest is your salvation. In quietness and trust is your strength. But you will have none of it. Verse 18 tells us, yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you. He rises to show you compassion. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all who wait for him. This is the word of the Lord.
The New Testament reading this morning is found in the Gospel of Luke, what has been called the lost and found chapter of the scriptures. And this morning we'll begin our New Testament reading in Luke chapter 15, beginning at verse 11. Jesus continued. There was a man set who had two sons, and the younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for the distant country. The man squandered the wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the land. He began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to the fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him any. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and sinned against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.'" So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servant, Quick, bring the best robe and bring it on. Put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For the son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so that I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fatted calf." "My son," the father said, "you're always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." Friends, this is the word of God. And to the people of God, and for the glory of God. Well, the Shanley boys were at the mall. My young sons, Ryan and Kyle, were running in and out of the clothing racks. All of a sudden, there was this eerie silence. I couldn't see them, and I couldn't hear them. "Kyle, Ryan," no answer. "Kyle, Ryan," still no answer. As I walked around the store, they were nowhere to be found. I thought, if I come home with only brand new sneakers and not two sons, Karen is not going to be happy with me. I thought, this is worse than a movie, "Honey, I Shrunk My Kids." As I was walking around and looking, I finally heard some giggling. I looked down and saw two pairs of sneakers that I recognized. Kyle and Ryan were playing hide and seek, but I didn't know that. Well, I had a few words with them. I hugged them, and we celebrated sharing an orange Julius. Now we were walking through the mall, and they were right in front of me so that I could see them. And as we were walking, I sang silently to myself, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a dad like me. My sons were lost and now they're found. and Karen's not going to kill me. Well, as you've heard through the scripture lessons, we're going to look at another father who lost two sons. One was the youngest son who was lost in a far country. The other was basically lost at home. And we'll see this as we get deeper into the parable. And I want you to know that the parables of Jesus always say something about him, and that they always say something about us. Now, right off the bat, Luke sets the context for us in this parable. In the first verse, he says that the tax collectors and sinners all were gathering around to hear him. But it was the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, in other words, the religious leaders, they were the ones that were falling into temptation. They were falling into sin. Why? Because among themselves, they were muttering that he welcomes sinners and he eats with them. How could he be God if he eats and shares table fellowship with, if you will, those people? In that time, table fellowship was a big deal. Who you were with defined who you were. And Jews with any kind of social standing would eat only with their kind. Any self-respecting Jew would not eat with notorious sinners. And especially, they would host them at their homes with a meal, just like Jesus did. But Jesus did this intentionally. It was part of his mission strategy. We're told from the scriptures that he came preaching the kingdom of God. And what better way to demonstrate that kingdom and its power than sharing a meal? Sharing a meal or a feast with repentant sinners. Jesus, we're told from the Bible, came to seek and to save the lost. And the lost were being found. They were being saved. And that meant the kingdom of God was coming. And the meals Jesus ate with them were like flashing neon lights, if you will, signs that said, the kingdom of God is here. And yet the Pharisees couldn't read the sign. Or perhaps they refused to, even if Jesus ate in their homes. Well, Jesus decides to defend himself, and he tells three parables. Now remember, a parable, on one hand, is a looking glass where we can see the truth of God. But it's also a mirror where we can see ourselves. Three parables. One about a lost sheep, one about a lost coin, and of course, the one we'll look at, the one about the lost son. The first parable is about a shepherd who leaves the 99 sheep to find one, the one that is lost. And when he finds it, we're told he rejoices and he wants to celebrate. I can picture him saying to his family and friends, the villagers, let's party. I wonder if he shared with them any kind of orange Julius Caesars. But who knows? The second parable was about a woman who loses a coin. She has 10 and she loses one. And because there were no windows in the house and it was an earthen floor, it was dark within the house and it was hard to find. But we're told she finds the one she loses. And she too rejoices. And she too wants to celebrate and perhaps have a huge party. Well, the first two parables, they end in joy. The third one about the lost son leaves us hanging. The sinner is the lost son. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law, the scribes, are the older son. And the question is, will they join the party? And their responses to Jesus determine how this story is really going to end and really will reflect their relationship with God. Now, this parable is probably one of the best known and best loved. This parable is right up there with the parable of the Good Samaritan. And I know you've heard this parable probably many times before because it's so rich and deep. So this morning, in the few minutes that we have, I'd like to explain, share with you of some aspects of that culture that maybe you didn't know, so that the story would be a little bit more richer and deeper for you. We're told that the action begins when the younger son asks for his inheritance. Now, actually, this was an insult to his father. This just wasn't done. What he was actually saying to his father, Lord, or Father, give me what is due, because I wish you were dead. Jesus's audience then would have picked up right away, and they would have expected the father perhaps to curse his son, beat him, and then disown him. But instead, the father gives the son what he wants. In other words, the father, being so rich in his love, gives the son the freedom to reject him. And I trust that you know that the father represents God. Well, the older son is also given his share, and because he's the oldest son, is probably given as twice as much than the younger son. And in that day, if a man wanted to give his property to his heirs before his death, he could do so, but it was still under the authority of the father. And this parable, the father makes the distribution. The older son should have objected right away. He should have refused. And he also should have tried to reconcile his little brother with the father. But we're basically told he didn't. He didn't fulfill his required duty. He just accepted his inheritance and stayed silent. Already we can see that there's something wrong with this older brother. Now, Junior, if you will, goes and sells his portion of the land for cash. And this too wasn't done. In that culture, the land didn't belong to you. You belong to the land. You inherit the land so that you can, yes, work it and then pass it on to the next generation. Land was life. You didn't sell it unless there was no other choice. We find that his younger son is selfish and sick at heart. So we're told that he goes away to a far and distant country, a Gentile country. Because he had money in his pocket, I'm sure he met a lot of people, a lot of so-called friends who just loved to spend his cash. This rich kid basically wastes his money in what the Revised Standard Version translates loose living. And later on, the brother says that it was because of his immorality. But Jesus basically and simply says he wasted all he had. The young man didn't respect his father, his inheritance, his money, or even the community. And so now he finds himself with no debt and no friends. And then we're told there's a famine. And as a foreigner, the young son finds himself vulnerable. He attaches himself to a citizen of that country. And perhaps you and I, in some cases, would imagine that he goes and looking to hire himself out so that he can have a job. But that really isn't so, according to the parable. Instead, he goes, as often poor people would, to a citizen of that country and was really looking for a handout. And the way that a citizen or a rich person in that country would basically get rid of the beggar would be to give him a job that really he wouldn't want. He would right off the bat refuse. Well, we see that he does get something to do, and that's to feed the pigs. Now, the Jews considered the pigs, well, basically unclean, and that doesn't mean just messy, but basically that they were religiously forbidden. And no self-respecting Jew would take on such a job, but this young guy had no choice. And he was living through what we would call, in a phrase, bad things come in threes. First, there was no food and no friends. There was a famine. And actually, then there was no food. And here he is. And we could be asking, well, why didn't he eat the food that the pigs were eating? Because what he was feeding them was basically a pod or a very cold carob. Now, this wasn't the sweet carob found in that part of the region. Gradually, he was feeding them the wild berries, the shrubs, that were eaten only when someone was really starving. And they tasted really bad. And they really had no significant nutritional value. Now, again, remember, there's a famine. So the pigs aren't really eating any quality food. So this youngster, if you will, did the work, hoping that he would be rewarded. But we're told no one gave him anything. At this point, we're told that the son repents. But if you really look into it, we find that it's a poor repentance. It's a repentance out of need and fear. He reasons that, well, the hired help on my father's land, they're better off than I am. So he decides to go back to his father and ask for a job. His son at this point had no concept of grace and he wasn't expecting it. He wants to earn his living. That way he can basically keep his self-respect and stay out of the thumb or under the thumb of his brother who was in charge back home. So as we find, he prepares what he thinks is a good speech and heads back to his family. Now, I think we need to know at this point, the farmers in the first century Palestine didn't live in isolation like we do or the farmers here in America. Don't, if you will, picture, and where I got this, I don't know, but don't picture, say, the farm in the movie The Wizard of Oz. On this big spread, the neighbor, next neighbor, is miles and miles away, and that's sitting on the porch with his dog right beside him. In Palestine, that didn't happen. All the farmers lived in little villages. The animals lived in nearby pens, and in some cases, even in their homes. The fields were spread out around the villages, and in most cases, everybody in the village was related. So if you will, keep that in your minds. And also imagine the scene where the son, he's off in the distance, and all of a sudden, his father spots him. What do you think the villagers were thinking if they saw him? You think they'd be happy to see him? This rebel? This one who dishonored his father? This one who dishonored the village? His arrival would have immediately been noticed. And he would have been put through some kind of rough treatment. Maybe cursing, maybe spitting, maybe even violence. He knows it's going to happen. Somehow he hopes he'll get through. But according to this parable, it doesn't happen. And the answer is because his father sees his coming and he runs to meet him. This time, Kyle wasn't hiding in the clothing racks. He was hiding in the mountains of Iraq as a recon marine. He was 3 months deployed, and if you will, a distant country. He was finally coming home. Already he was a day late in his return, and Karen and I were standing in front of his barracks in Camp Lejeune with other families and friends waiting for their return. All of a sudden, 6 buses filled with Marines, 250 of them, pulled up into the parking lot. Karen was at one end of the lot, and I was at the other with a sign that had his name, Kyle, I was holding up. As the Marines came off the buses, I just turned and happened to see Karen, but she was bending over, tears coming down her eyes, as she was taking pictures of Kyle walking toward her. Now, when I finally spotted him, Do you think I just stood there and waited for him to come to me? I don't think so. I ran and I dodged a lot of Marines and finally got to him. I was filled with compassion and pride, and yes, my eyes were leaking too. I hugged him and I kissed him. He was our firstborn, our son, and our hero. We continued with our reunion, and through the hours of the night, we celebrated, we even partied. We even had the fatted calf. Well, it was more like Burger King hamburgers. but that's what Pai wanted. In this story, we find that the father also didn't wait for his son to come to him. Picture, if you will, him probably dodging the villagers. And yet, in that time, for a man of social standing to run would be beneath his dignity. So here in his action, the dad humiliates himself to reach his son before he would run the gauntlet of the villagers. The father runs to protect his son and to restore his position. Now, before we go any further, I want you to know, maybe you already know, the meaning of the word prodigal, because we're looking at the familiar parable of the prodigal son. Well, that word parable of the prodigal, and that word prodigal actually means extravagant or lavish. And we can see this in how the father extravagantly lavished his grace, his peace, and his love on his son. And we'll find that he lavishes gifts on his son as well. So we can actually call this parable the parable of the prodigal father. And actually, I like that better. As we move through this parable, notice that the boy comes and he delivers his speech. But he leaves the part out about being of hired hands. Why is that? Because the father cut him off before he could say it? Or because the son was shrewd and saw that he could get much more? I don't think so. I think it was because the boy was finally moved by his father's dramatic and lavish love. He finally understood grace. Being a son again would mean living off the land, being under the thumb of his brother, as well as losing his independence. But he had seen his father's love. So he got to the point where he swallowed his pride, and was told he came in fear, and yet his father's love overwhelmed him, to the point where he opened up and repented. Now, the father is so happy, we're told that he lavishes his son with first the robe. And not just a robe, it was his father's robe, the best robe that was only worn on special occasions. This meant an acceptance back into the community. The ring signifies, well, there was a trust. And the sandals told everybody, this is my son, he is not a servant. And then there was the fatted calf. Not a sheep, not a goat, not a rubber chicken or cold peas, but a fatted calf. There was a party in the village, everyone was invited. The father was now reconciling his son to the whole village. Friends, on this first Sunday in Lent, we get to ask, who is Jesus and what does he do? Well, according to the scriptures, Jesus is the Son of God and forgives sinners and brings the kingdom of God. And we see this in this parable. The father runs to meet and welcome his son. And what does that look like in real life? Well, like Jesus welcoming repentant sinners. And from our perspective, the Father humiliates himself for love of the Son, that hopefully reminds us of the incarnation and death of Jesus. The Father throws a party. Again, what does that mean? What does that look like in real life? Well, it means Jesus shared meals with repentant sinners like Zacchaeus. But today it's the church. Our worship and our fellowship are supposed to be a kingdom party. We celebrate the grace of God, but more importantly, we experience it in our lives. Yes, the Father lost both sons, and yet he loved them both. And when the older son returns home, because we could have ended with the younger son, the celebration, dead and alive, lost and found, and they lived happily ever after. But the scripture says, meanwhile, and that's when the older son shows up. And in the words of, you remember, Cool and the Gang, those musicians, there's a party going on right here. There's a celebration. The older son got angry. His duty as a son obligated him to go into the house and help his father entertain the guests. But we're told he refused. Again, the father humiliates himself by going out to the son to plead with him. And Jesus ends the parable that forces the Pharisees to choose how it's going to end. The Pharisees, we know, hated Jesus, but Jesus didn't hate them. He did say some harsh things to them that they needed to hear, but he also invited them to the party. With this parable, he caught them off guard. And this parable shows us Jesus as the full expression of the Father's love. He comes in humiliation. Humiliation to reconcile you and me to his heavenly Father. Paul, in his letter to the Philippians, put it this way. He says, being in very nature God, he did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. Jesus made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in the appearance of a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. So what does that say about you and me? The two sons represent two different kinds of people. The older son was estranged and rebellion in the house, just as the younger son was outside the house in a distant country. See, when you peel back the layer after layer of sin, what is really exposed is our pride. And the older son basically asked his father, where's mine? Where's mine? See, this parable will ask us to lay down our pride and receive the grace that the Father gives us through his son, Jesus Christ. And the reason so that you and I can be sons and daughters again, so that we can submit to Jesus, to his authority, and to know his great love. If you will, picture again the Father running to meet and welcome his son. The Father with his hands, his arms wide open. This is in the incarnation, when the eternal Son became certainly a human being. And why did he do it? To make you a daughter or son of God again. And that's the cross. The cross with Jesus' arms wide open. And why did he do it? He did it for you. He did it for me. He did it for the world. We were once lost in our family. We were once dead. And we are alive. Friends, through this season of Lent, whether you're hiding in the clothing racks or not. Know that in Jesus invites you and all sinners and saints alike to enter the Father's house, to celebrate, to join the party. And who knows, he might hand you an orange juice. Amen.
Oh, God. Sorry.
No.
Okay.
Was that it for the?
Yeah.
Okay. And once again, we have come to the portion of the program where we are inviting you to make a donation here for the church. You can make these donations through the app Give Plus, or by mail to the church at 494 Beverly Rancocas Road, Woodenboro, New Jersey, 08046, or on the church's website at presbychurchwillenboro.org. And something I actually heard a couple days ago on the radio, it was a semi-new song by Bon Jovi, actually. And it was entitled, uh,
I know I was going somewhere with this. Don't give, don't do what you do, do what you can. And pretty much what that says is, I know everything has been really, really complicated with how everything has been, you know, locally, globally, everywhere. So even though you may not be able to give what you used to, or give what you would like to, give what you're able to, and that'll always be appreciated. Thank you.
Gracious and eternal God, in Jesus Christ we are reconciled to you, made new by your grace and gifted by your love. We ask that you use us and use the gifts that we bring as signs of your love, for the promise to serve you in this way, in worship, in witness, and in work, to your glory, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Calvary love of God, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with you now and remain with you always. And God bless you.
Amen.